Hi, you guys. So I wanted to come and touch on this documentary that's out here. It's on YouTube, but I'm not sure where else you can find it. But someone uploaded the documentary to YouTube as well. It's a German documentary. So I'm not real sure why they wanted to touch on this topic, because when you go to their page, however, you will see that they do cover just global conversations, right? And the name of the documentary is The Black Upper Class in America, America's Black Upper Class, I believe is how it's titled. So what I wanted to do was to play bits and pieces of it and kind of just discuss it. But I will say it's an uplifting project. I think that they were coming from a good place. I want to say that. I don't want it to make anybody think that I'm trying to say anything negative about it. But they are German. It's the German film company that comes in to put this documentary together. So you kind of have to wonder, like, okay, why would they think to do this topic? But I'll let you guys hear a little bit of what they have to say. If you have not seen, because it was very successful on their YouTube channel anyway. They've gotten over close to 5 million views on it. So you probably have already watched it. If not, you should go and watch it. It is inspiring. So I'm going to play a little bit from it, and then I'll come back.
In the United States, there are more and more African-American millionaires. Their number has doubled over the past 25 years. Today, one in 50 black families are millionaires, part of a new black upper class in the country.
$5,000, I mean, we built the company to be a multi-million dollar business.
Today, black people make up the second largest group of millionaires in the U.S., behind white Americans. But the country carries a long history of slavery, segregation, and discrimination. For the general public, the most well-known wealthy African Americans are athletes, politicians, and entertainers.
You ain't African American queen.
That's a fact.
But far away from Los Angeles and its Hollywood stars, there's a different black elite, and it's on the rise. An upper class that makes up 3% of the African American population. This may not seem like much, but it's nearly 1.5 million people.
So yeah, as you can hear, they're saying that it's nearly 1.5 million people that make up this black upper class. And I did not fact check anything in the documentary as of yet, because some of it I don't know that I necessarily feel that is a fact. I don't know. I would have to check the stats and the numbers and just kind of do some research on it to really know. And I haven't done that. I just was watching the documentary a couple weeks ago, because this came out about a month now, and I've been wanting to put this documentary, to talk about it up. Because like I said, there are definitely some inspiring stories in there. I know the couple with the wife, she started the hair Caroline, and she said she started with $5,000, right? And she is now, a multimillionaire. The company is doing well. Her and her husband are now running the company. And so her story is part of it. And then there are some other parts of the documentary that kind of explains how the companies were able to reach success. And I think that's what they were reaching for with this documentary, because that's what I was trying to understand. And so if you really listen to a lot of it, you do recognize that black people supporting other black people by way of patronizing these services and these companies is a part of the success of these companies. Right, because most of the people that you're going to see in the documentary, first of all, the documentary spends a lot of time based in Atlanta, which you guys know that Atlanta's story is probably the only story that's out here right now. And I mean, even though that is changing, with the gentrification you know, certain elements in politics who don't have that community, how can I put it? They don't think in terms of community, right? So there are people who have a lot of African-American people, in particular in my generation and the younger ones, that have an island mentality where it's just about individual success. And as long as I have individual success, I don't care that anyone else that looks like me is there. And so when you have a lot of that mentality building and outbuilding, outgrowing the mentality of community, you're going to see that change in Atlanta as well. And it's already happening. Like I said, because I live there, so I know what I'm saying. And so right now, yeah, you can probably still find the bulk of money outside of the entertainment industry in Black business in Atlanta, Black businesses in Atlanta, for that reason, because people once, it's particular in the South, thought in community terms. People do not feel that way today. And so that is going to affect us as a community. And I think that's what this documentary says. And that's kind of why I wanted to make a video about it and kind of to say people should watch it. So they can see this for themselves. There is a gentleman in the video. His name is Don Peebles. And actually, it could kind of throw you off. Because he is at the beginning of the documentary. And he looks mixed or multiracial. I think he says, and the lady that is hosting the documentary, who's actually interviewing the people, that the couples and the families that she's talking to, she actually straight out says to him, do you think that you, the fact that you're not married to a Black person, is affecting the generational wealth, right? And he then responds, because he is introduced as an African-American person, but then when she asks him that question, he of course changes his nationality to I am a multiracial person. He says I'm multiracial. And so it kind of changes the conversation for him. But I was looking into him, and he has invested a great deal. I forget what city he's at. I think he's somewhere in the East Coast. And he's a real estate developer. And his father was a person in real estate as well. So the generational attachment is there, right? To wealth and how to obtain it, right? But because his family dynamic is now changing, and obviously it even changed with him, because obviously he is not even, you know, he doesn't have two African-American parents, and he says that he's multiracial. You will see that doesn't, you know, the lady's right, financially that doesn't, add into our story. But he does give back, and he has programs set up where he's investing in women, minority, not just Black women, minority women and minority groups. And he donates and raises money and all that stuff. And I kind of tried to include that in this video about him, to say that, because that will kind of throw people off, because he is the first story of the video. But then as the video goes on, they are talking to other entrepreneurs, and like I said, most of them are based in Atlanta. And this video is not about athletes and entertainers and stuff like that. So this is about Black people doing for self. It's supposed to be a self, you know, doing for self, identifying how to obtain these things for ourselves. And so it kind of goes into that after the Don Peebles piece of it. You know, I mean, he has a right to, I guess in this country, you can identify yourself as whatever you want to, and that's the thing. And then people, you know, they do what they want to do, and they identify themselves how they want to identify themselves based on the need for that. But when you really think about collective wealth, is that really ours? Is that the real conversation? And so it is what it is. Like I said, I did look into him, and I see that he at least he will, you know, he puts his money where his mouth is at the end of the day. And that's really all you can really say about that. At the end of the day, this is America. So, but the rest of the stories they go on, people are telling how they came, were able to become successful. There's also, I don't know if she's a journalist. I want to call her a journalist because she's an author. She talks about that a lot as well, about the fact that we have to invest in ourselves as a community. And that is what is helping us to have that story. And that is the story of Atlanta, whether people want to own that or not, because the city of Atlanta at one time was majority Black. It is still has a large black population, and there is no other city outside of Washington, D.C. that can say that. There's no other Black city in America, right, that can honestly say that they have that level of a population. It's not there. And so, other than Washington, D.C., like I said, and so what happened with Atlanta, and living there, I can see it, because everywhere you go, you're going to be able to find a Black doctor. You're going to be able to find the Black lawyers. You're going to see, obviously, the Black politicians, and there have been Black mayor after Black mayor there around now for the past several years. And even before Miss Shirley, there was someone, there were Black mayors and people in office, people in position to make decisions or to speak up to make decisions on our behalf. And so even though there's still discrimination, I know there's a story out here right now about Keisha Lance Bottoms, who was just recently discriminating against in a restaurant. They were not wanting to let her in over the shoes she had on, and they didn't know who she was, apparently. It's still a lot of that. I think one of the radio shows when I still lived in Atlanta, I think it was Frank Ski, who kind of talked about, because obviously he's a DJ and he is a part of that nightlife, how they change the price of parking, and they, they do all this stuff. Y'all know who I'm talking about, other people. And even some Black people do it as well. So I let me correct that, because Black people doing certain things to other Black folk these days as well. Just the discrimination, putting the parking up, making it more harder for people to be able to rent locations or to bring certain events into the city. They kept moving the Caribbean, the carnival. They moved in, and it was in downtown Atlanta at one time, and then it had to move, and now it's confusing to keep up with it, and there's more than one going on, I think, now as well. But they're on the outside of Atlanta now. And like Amaretta is saying in that song, once you get outside of Atlanta, you're not in Atlanta. So Atlanta had a Black population. When you start going into those suburbs and into these other areas of Georgia, they are not Black, okay? So people should be clear about that, and they should understand where they are when they do roll into these places, because that is still the South. And I said what I said. And I don't care who don't like it. I said what I said. Anyway, and so the success that you see in Atlanta is because we are going to pay, we can patronize each other there, because we see the shops and the restaurants owned by Black people, the bars, the events that are held with Black people who are a part of putting them together, and being able to make those things successful for them. And you see that you watch my back and I watch your back mentality. That is not in most places in America, right? So you're not gonna see those same levels of success in these cities. And I said what I said on that. Can't nobody prove what I'm saying wrong, because you can't point, like I said, to no other city in America that's doing that outside of Atlanta. And I think that that is what has made Atlanta that way, is because Black people they've had that mentality over the years, even though, like I said, that is now changing, because you're having these politicians and stuff that are getting into position, and they're bringing in these outside communities and screaming all this stuff about diversity, and that's fine. But you need to also realize that we still have to look out for our own. And if we're not doing that, nobody's going to do that. These people are going to come into Atlanta and they're not going to look out for our community. They're going to bring in managers and CEOs and all these people that look like them. And those people don't have to hire us. And they can use whatever excuse to go around the law. It don't matter what law is in place. I have looked at so many discrimination cases out here that's still out here in 2022. So we're not going to pretend like discrimination and all these things don't still happen. People just know how to go around the law to discriminate. Okay, so so you're seeing the face of that change. I know they're we're saying, I don't even want to get into him, but one of the mayors that was there, how he was trying to push all the black people south, because he was, when they were building that arena for the, what is it called? The Benz, whatever it is, arena, they thought that was going to be a prime area for real estate, and he was bringing in all these investors, which was going to remove all of the people that were living in these areas who were making certain income. Everyone can't afford to live in all these high rises and all that stuff, right? They do have an upper class in Atlanta, but everybody in Atlanta is not upper class. Everybody can't afford the stuff that you're bringing in here. So you're going to change the look of these areas that once looked a certain way. And that was a big conversation while I was still living there. And then he was voted out or whatever, however he ended up leaving. And Keisha came in. Now she's out here dealing with a discrimination situation, right? Because we have to remember that though. And I think if you watch this documentary, you do see that we do have to look out for each other. Otherwise, these situations are not gonna come in play. Right, Don Peoples don't even look black, so obviously he's gonna have success regardless. He's screaming he African-American, biracial, multiracial, or whatever else he chooses to identify himself based on the way he looks. Okay, and I said what I said on that. Thandi Newton, I already told y'all, child, they the chosen ones. Okay. Anyway, and so I thought it was interesting that this documentary is based in Atlanta for the most part, but you will see some other familiar faces in there. They're going to touch on Killer Mike and this bank situation, which I don't really think is a bank. I think it's a debit card, to my understanding. Tiga is a part of it because of one of the real estate agents who say, she's doing very well for herself there in Atlanta. And he was saying that he purchased this house from her. And so it is that community thing that is what is the secret for the success of Atlanta. And so I thought that was interesting that plays out in the documentary. I want to play this last guy because he has a website, I believe it's called We Buy Black, I think that's what it's called. I'll play it and you guys will hear their name in the clip here. But let me know what you guys think about the documentary. If you've already watched it, do you get what I'm saying? That Atlanta can really say that they have that success, number one, because they have the black population there. And also they have people there who still have that community mentality. And without that, these people would not be successful. Because when you start bringing, like I said, in all these other communities, and I don't have any issue with diversity at all, but when we're doing that, we also have to remember that people don't tend to hire black people. Like all of these people that's in this documentary are self-made. Okay, nobody's saying they work for this or that of company or firm or whatever. All of these people in this documentary are self-made, and so that says something as well within itself. They're not working for Fortune 500 companies. This is not how they rose to these levels of success. Maybe in real estate, yeah, you had to work for whoever in the beginning. But when I'm sure the young lady that you see in the documentary is probably working for within her own agency at this point, for her to make the type of money that she's saying that she's pulling in, it sounds like she is the broker. And so you're gonna see that in this documentary, what I'm saying about the community aspect of it. I'm gonna play his his piece. I believe his name is Muhammad, but I'm going to play his company. He owns this website that it features Black products, Black-owned companies. And but let me know what you guys thought about the documentary if you watched it. And if you haven't watched it, it's at DW Documentaries. And you can put that in the search engine here on YouTube to watch it. Like I said, this is not entertainment focused. So this is not about athletes and Oprah and all these people who have all this money. You know, this is about how the upper class or working class, middle class, how they have been able to reach success outside of the entertainment industry. And like I said, you will see the reoccurring story of the fact that it's these companies are community-based. Except for, you know, probably the people in real estate. But even then, you know, a lot of them are probably getting support from the African-American community as well. So I'm going to end with Muhammad. Let me know what you guys thought about the documentary. And if you haven't watched it, go over and watch it at DW Documentaries. And I'll see you guys in the next video.
In the United States, there are more and more African-American. In the United States, there are more and more African-American millionaires. Their number has doubled over the past 25 years. This graduate was quick to spot the potential of the growing Buy Black movement. He founded WeBuyBlack.com in 2015. The website sells products from Black-owned businesses and sellers, everything from clothing to household goods. It took the Black community by storm, soon racking up more than 100,000 customers and nearly a million social media followers.
So for a very long time, hundreds of years, we've always supported and bought white. This could be rooted from a lot of African Americans believing that that the Caucasian was God. A lot of African Americans viewed white products and products sold from white people as superior products. So this was a statement and a reaction to say something different, to turn the table and say, no longer will we buy white, but it's time for us to buy blacks.
In his 500 square meter warehouse, he stores products for several brands that are sold on his site. Among the flagship products, one sells particularly well, boxer shorts.
Everything good. Good to see everything you. Going, man.
Everything cool, man. Just on We Buy Black. We got a new banner.
Okay, nice, nice.
Yeah, that is right there.
Oh, yeah, I love that.
Uh-huh.
No, 9 different styles here?
9 different styles. 3 in a pack. We got the Royale Edition with the purple, burgundy, and royal blue.
Nice.
And then we got one more product coming out. I've been testing these out the prototype.
Okay.
Champ slides.
Nice.
I've been wearing them for 2 weeks straight.
Nice. They holding up well.
Holding up well. Nice. Vintage, but
we jump started off WeBuyBlack.com. Without WeBuyBlack.com, I don't know where we'd be standing at right now. Yeah. So from the launch, there was a press release, and it was through WeBuyBlack. And that's what got us the momentum that we needed. So I can say we're doing much better thanks to WeBuyBlack. Very essential.
Thanks to the website, this entrepreneur is guaranteed more visibility and more sales. And customers are happy too.
Oh yeah, I'm wearing Champs right now. Yeah, yeah, yeah. I will show you, but you know, if it was all men here. Yeah.
Sharif Abdul-Malik's goal is to produce and carry as many everyday items as possible. Alongside boxer shorts and laundry detergent, the young entrepreneur is now moving on to dental hygiene.
Here is the first African-American-owned toothbrush company. It's probably the first toothbrush. You know, we'll normally see white-skinned people on the back of products. So this right here is just probably the first toothbrush that ever has melanated models on the back of their on the back of the packaging. But my years of living, I never saw it as well. Everything does not have to have a white person on it, that you can actually have black people in your products.
Though he may dream of more all-black labels, he might have to make some concessions.
This product here is made in China.
Is it made by a black Chinese?
So that's a good question though, because all over the world we get products made. You know, in China they get their raw material from Africa.
The young entrepreneur is doing all he can to help establish an all-black economy. Today, he's about to take it a step further. He plans
So yeah, let me know what you guys think about the documentary and the stories that are a part of it in the comments. And I'll see you guys in the next video.